मूर्तये नमः सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां आत्मस्वरूप बंधुगण। वी विल से द फर्स्ट वर्स अगेन बिकॉज सम एडजस्टमेंट हैज टू बी डन देयर। प्रातस्मरामि हृदि संस्फुरदात्मतत्वम्। सच्चित् सुखं परमहंस गतिं तुरीयम्। यत् स्वप्न जागर सुषुप्तम वैति नित्यम्। तद्ब्रह्म निष्कलमहं न च भूतसंघः। Now we come to the second verse, which is the beginning of the regular class. Pratar bhajami manaso vachasamagamyam vacho vibhanti nikhilayadanugrahena yam neti neti vachanaihi गमा अवोचम् तम देवदेवमजम् अच्युतमाहुरग्रियम्। प्रातः भजामि भज भज सेवायाम् सेवा। बट हियर व्हाट इज द सेवा दैट यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट? It is not any physical activity, you know. So the person is in contemplation. So in contemplation, what is the meaning of seva? Bhajanam, bhaja means bhajanam. Bhajanam is sevanam. Really speaking, bhajanam nama rasanam. That is the meaning. Means I relish, I savor. That is the meaning of it. Pratah bhajami. Early in the morning, before the mind gets crowded by the vasanas of the samsara, that is what happens. That's why meditation is highly recommended early in the morning. Because when you wake up, it is the sattva guna of the mind which comes into the fore. Because sattva guna is same as waking up. Both are one and the same. The fact that you wake up and become aware, that is sattva guna. That means already the sattvic aspect of the mind has captured the reflection of the awareness universal. Then only you become aware. Not of anything in particular. The particular is the child of the mind. It is already the mind is in operation. So the mind is just waking up. But not all its vasanas. The vasanas are dormant yet. So that is the early morning time. The first moments of waking up are obviously like that. And the vasanas, they will become very active. They blossom really, they bloom as the time progresses. That's why before the vasanas are in full sway, or full swing, and we are under the sway of those vasanas, before that happens, that will happen very soon. Within half an hour it may happen. If you can stall it for an hour so that you have some meditation session going on, then you have accomplished a big thing really. So the vasanas, they flood in very quickly. That's why early morning meditation is recommended. Before you take breakfast and all that, before 7:30, 7 is already the last point. You cannot have beyond 7:30. If you start meditation at 7:30, you won't get that absorption. You'll be doing something. Something has to be done, therefore you do. Really speaking, at the initial, once you have that kind of a discipline and a command of the mind, such that you maintain the mind in the sattvic mode all the time, for a length of time, then it's all right. You can do meditation any time. But in the initial stages, When the mind is dominated by rajas and tamas, so it is the early morning time when you wake up, for the obvious reason that all the vasanas, the proclivities of the mind, they are not yet blooming, they are in dormant condition. At that time, if you do meditation, then there is the chance of getting communion with the reality which is already there, which is always there. The reality, we are always seeking for the thing which is already there. Therefore, you get that communion, and as the communion, it becomes stronger and stronger, then the flow will happen. The flow of the reality into life. Now what happens is, we are living a life which has unfortunately no connection with the reality. Therefore, we have to allow the reality to flow into life. You know what I mean? I'm not talking of any physical flow or any such thing. So in a metaphorical way I'm saying, so our thoughts have nothing to do with the reality. Naturally, our speech and our actions are so far divorced from the reality, it is a very unfortunate state of affairs. Therefore, we have to achieve that communion in meditation early in the morning. Therefore, the best time for meditation is morning time. And then the meditation should not be an enforced labor, like yogasana. So look at the time, half an hour session. 9:30 you started or 3:30 you started. Okay, at the end of the yogasana, a cup of coffee is waiting. Before, let us bear with this thing for half an hour. So like that enforced labor. So you have to stretch hand, you have to stretch leg. And so very reluctantly you stretch it. You don't feel like stretching. But then if you don't stretch, something undesirable may happen. The body may become sick. Therefore, we are caught in a kind of laziness on one side and the fear of the future on the other. Therefore, reluctantly we stretch. It should not be like that. We should not convert the whole thing into an enforced labor. Meditation, we should develop friendship with meditation. We should befriend the meditation. Unfortunately, as long as you befriend the samsara, you will not be able to befriend the atma. Let me tell you this. Either you are with Caesar, or you are with the other, whatever they say, mammon, or either you are with the god or with the mammon. You cannot have god in one pocket and mammon in the other pocket. It is not going to work like that. So the thing is, you have to befriend the meditation. Meditation means it is a savoring experience. I relish it. Pratar bhajami. And what is it that you relish? What is it that you savor? I cannot explain it. Vachasam agamyam. First, manasaha vachasam. That matter is there, you know. Suppose you put it in the order. Vachasam manasaha agamyam. The matter will go, matter will not be fitting. Therefore, he put it as manaso vachasam agamyam. So, you can explain from the other side also, really speaking. So, this is one thing which is consistently said in the Upanishadic literature and in the Vedantic literature. You see, the truth, the reality that we are talking about is not attained. Agamya. Gamya means attainable. Gam, attain. Gamya, one which can be attained. Attainable. Gantum shakyam. So, gamya. And so you can attain the truth with words, suppose. Then that means what? What do you mean by attaining the truth with words? Suppose you want to know what is, what are the Newton's laws. How can I tell you Newton's laws? Using the words only. So the words have a capacity to convey the truth, to convey the knowledge or information, whatever name you give to it. Of course, in the case of Newton's laws, it is empirical truth only. Even from the standpoint of physics, it is empirical. In the sense, because classical physics is not accepted in modern days, you know, it is modern physics. So, you need not come to Vedanta to say Newton's laws are not applicable all the way. You need not come to Vedanta. Within physics itself, they get negated. Anyway, so middle zones only it works. Everything works in middle zones. So, just be in the middle zones, Newton's laws are okay. Samsara is okay. be in the middle zones. You don't want to come to this side or that side, just be in the middle zones. You don't need Einsteinian physics or some other physics. Newton's physics is okay, but that is not how the world functions, you know. So Vedanta is also like that. Anyway, the point is, with the Shabda Shakti hi Achintya, the words have a power. Shabda Shakti we call it. The power, they do things. How they do? Suppose I utter a word, Rama, I say. The moment I say Rama, an entire meaning is invoked in your mind. You know what is Rama. Rama is the God, an incarnation of Lord Vishnu, worshipped throughout the length and breadth of Bharat. So a lot of information floods into your mind, Rama. Uttering is momentary. In a fraction of a second I say it. It's a very small sound. Even a child can say it. But the power of conveying, how much knowledge or information it brings out in your mind, it is something amazing. So Shabda Shakti hi Achintya. The power of the words is really mind-boggling. That much power the words have. But then words have their limitation also. We have to understand the limitation of the words. You see, language is a mental tool. We should not forget that fact. It is the tool of the mind. And that is number one about language or words. Two, language operates in opposites only. So generally that is how it is. And therefore, if the reality is part and parcel of the empirical world, and the language is the tool of the mind, which is used by the mind to describe the empirical world, the empirical reality. And if the truth is part and parcel of the empirical world, then the language can capture the truth, can encapsulate the truth within itself. And with the speech, you will be able to convey the truth. For understanding Newton's laws, Shravanam is enough. You don't need Mananam and Nididhyasanam. You just listen to the lecture, or even you need not even listen to the lecture, just sit at home and read it and understand, also possible. Distance education is also possible. So, because the language is capable, is a tool that is enough to do the job of giving the knowledge to you. So, but the reality that we are talking about in Vedanta, you see, we call it Brahma, the reality, the ultimate, the truth. We have a name for it. It is called Brahma. Why it is called Brahma? What is the reason for calling it Brahma? It is not some kind of an exotic name given to the reality. There is a very significant meaning in that word. Brahma means Desha Kala Vastu Paricheda Rahitam. It transcends the threefold limitations. It is a reality which is not contained in space. It is a thing which is not defined by the flow of time, which is not the time, the contours of time cannot really limit this reality. And then the world, when we look at it, like the world, what we see is the plurality. That is what we see. We always see the opposites, the divisions and the plural. That is what we see. So, nana is the, that is how the Shruti looks at it. Nana, you see the nana, the manyness, the plurality, that is what you see. And the plurality alone is expressed by this mental tool called language. And that's why when you use a word, immediately, the word carries a distinction with it. It carries a distinction. So the unmanifest reality, the Brahman, it has no name, it has no form, it has no distinctions. If you have a pair of opposites, then the reality, it is not within the field of opposites. It's a sphere, it transcends the field of opposites. It is that's why we use words which take the reality away from the empiricality of our mind and the sense organs and the speech, etc. So, for example, the reality is called Sama. Throughout Gita, the truth, the Brahman, is presented by the word Sama. It is Sama. Sama is the same. What do you mean by same? Okay, you speak, you bring out distinctions. You think, you bring out distinction. Because it is the nature of thought to make it distinct, to make it separate. And then having made separation, it brings in the opposition also. That is how the mind functions. Thought, it has to isolate one thing from everything else and pit one thing against the everything else, and that is how it thinks and that is how it operates. That is how the mind functions. And the language is nothing but a tool for the mind. It's a mental tool. Therefore, the language and the mind, the thought process, they function in the sphere of opposites, in the sphere of plurality, in the sphere of distinctions. Whereas the truth is beyond the opposites. It is samam. So, samam means it just negates the opposites. Suppose you talk in terms of length. You say, dirgham hraswam. It is longer or shorter. Dirgha hraswa. These are the distinctions. The moment the parameter called length comes into your mind, the moment you try to describe the parameter called length, then immediately there are two words, dirgha, hraswa. Dirgha is long, hraswa is short. Long and short. So the moment you say long, it's a distinction. The moment you say short, it is a distinction. So the words operate in distinctions only. And the Upanishad comes and says, what is Brahma? Adirgham, ahraswam. It is neither long nor short. Then maybe it is subtle. When you say is it subtle when you ask that question, you have already a distinction associated with the thought called subtle and the word called subtle. There is a gross and with reference to that subtle. There is subtle with reference to that gross. So Shruti comes and says, asthulam ananu. Anu is subtle. Sthula is gross. It is neither gross nor subtle. So, words operate in distinctions, carry distinctions, whereas the reality is beyond all these distinctions. Therefore, language being a mental tool, it cannot really capture the reality. In fact, whatever you speak is a speech only, and whatever you think is thought only. The real is unexplainable. Vachasam agamyam. You cannot explain it. And then, and also at the same time, you cannot conceive it. What you conceive is a concept, not the truth. What you ideate is an idea, not the truth. What you think is a thought, not the truth. Therefore, we should first discover the limitations of the tools that we have. And then, so vachasam agamyam. This is what the Shruti also says, yato vacho nivartante. The words, they try to reach it, but fail to reach it. It is like you throw a stone, take a stone, and want to hit the moon. So you throw the stone with all the power you have in your hand, you throw it. Somebody may throw it a little height, somebody else may be able to throw it much higher, depending upon his power of throwing. But ultimately, the stone is not going to reach the moon. It is not going to hit the moon. Then what will happen to the throne, to the stone? It will come back. Nivartante. So, a less informed person may use one set of words or language or sentences to capture the reality. A more informed person may use more sophisticated language to capture the reality. Everything will turn back, return back. You are not going to capture the reality with speech. You are not going to capture the reality in the contours of a thought. Thought being what it is, you cannot capture reality, you cannot objectify the reality with a thought. So, manasaha vachasam agamyam. In fact, I tell you, if the reality is within the reach of the mind, then words also can reach it. Because words reach what all the mind reaches. Words cannot reach beyond the mind. Therefore, then what is the relevance of words? Do they have any relevance or not? They do have a relevance. It is not this kind of relevance, namely the words, you know, in their glory, go and capture the reality and show it before you. No, not that kind of relevance. They don't have that kind of relevance. Then what is the relevance of the words? You see, first words and then silence. You see, to say, I don't know, the person must be a visionary, nothing short of a visionary. Suppose I asked a person, do you know God? Yes, he said, I know God. In fact, God is sitting in our home, or he is sitting in our shrine. We were worshipping God since our childhood because my parents taught me to worship God. Okay, good. So you know the name of God? Why not? I know quite a few names of the God. And I know how he looks also, what he carries in which hand, I know that. Where he lives also, I know. Okay, so you know everything about God. But somebody else says God is not like this, he is like something else. No, he doesn't know. The God that I know is the truth. The name of the God which I call the real name, that is the real name. The form of the God which I worship is the real form. This is the problem. So I think human beings go through this kind of an initial stage, but then having gone through that stage, and then you grow and grow and grow, and a stage comes. He has been a student of scriptural literature. He has studied Veda, this, that. He has been a student for decades, and then to begin the child's life, the life began as a very innocent child. The child is very innocent and ignorant. But the ignorance of the child is not the issue because it is innocent. But gradually we grow up and we lose all our innocence and become very sophisticated in our mind and also the mental tool called language. We become very sophisticated. And all that sophistication and that scholarship, etc., the name and fame, it goes on and on and on. And then out of that, if the person goes in the right direction, a maturity will come. And having spoken words after words after words, read books after books after books, then a stage will come when he says, you go and ask him. He has lived with the scriptures for decades, and you go and ask him, do you know God? You know what will he do? You may not ask him. In fact, everybody should consider this in one's own meditative way. We should sit quietly and consider, do I know God? Do I know God? What is God? Is it the word G-O-D, God? Is word the God? Is the word table? Is it the table? Is word kheer? Is it kheer? Is word God? Is it God? Then do I know God? Do I really know God? What is God? Do I know it? And then you contemplate upon it. And then you will come to a conclusion, my God, I do not know. You say that. In utter amazement, you say, I do not know God. When you say, I do not know, the speech ends. And the mind resolves. The mind is no more intervening. And it is not an experience. Experience belongs to the mind. It is not an experience. It is, if I can call it, it is an experiencing, which is a timeless reality, which is timeless. Let us just leave it like that, which is timeless. Experience is captured within time, whereas experiencing is timeless. And in that experiencing of no knowledge, the mind cannot capture it. And no speech, because the speech cannot capture it. In that experiencing, you are in communion with Ishvara, with the reality. Yasyamatam tasyamatam. In Keno Upanishad, this is the major topic in Keno Upanishad. Suvedeti. The teacher asked the student, you know well, Brahma, Suvedeti Brahma? They say, yes, we know. Then immediately he says, Dabhrameva apinonam. Indeed, what you have known is very little. He did not say you do not know anything. He did not want to disappoint them. So you have known very little. What you have known something, but that is very little. Brahma is not little, you know. You cannot know a little of Brahma, you know. Brahma has no parts. If it has parts, maybe a part, a small part you have known, and the remaining parts you can eventually know. It is not like that. Therefore, dabhrameva api nonam. You have indeed known very little. The idea is, you pursue this study. Then a stage comes, yasya amatam, tasya matam. One who says, in utter amazement and wonder, in total self-surrender of the faculties, in total wonder, this is what we call bhakti. In that amazement, one says, no, I do not know God. I was dabbling with this thing called God all my life, but I do not know. Once he reaches that stage, when you say that, when you say, I know, it is the mind operating. And when you say, I do not know, the mind is not there. You are there. And you are the God. So this way, the silence will come after words. First words, then silence. In fact, one must be ripe for silence. That ripening happens in words of the scriptures. Therefore, words have a role to play, no doubt. But that doesn't mean words will capture the truth. Because what happens, the truth is timeless and spaceless. And the thought functions within the confines of space-time. When the moment thought comes, already it is bound in space and it is bound in time. You see what mind can do. Joy and sorrow, desires and fears, these are the states of mind. Realization of unity, it is beyond the mind. It is when the mind resolves that the truth presents itself. So then, what is the meaning of the words? What is it that they do? You see, they help the person, they train the person. The person is tamasic and rajasic. That is how we are to begin with. We are tamasic and rajasic. And then we study scriptures. We do shravanam. Then gradually, the tamas and rajas will be neutralized. And then we get established in sattva. It is like the mirror. Mind is like the mirror, but very dirty mirror. Therefore, you take a wet cloth, piece of cloth, and then mop it up. Mirror cannot invite the sun. Mirror can make it, cannot invite the sun, cannot bring the sun and present it to you. The mirror can remain clean. That is all it can do. Once the mirror remains clean, the sun reflects by itself. And the mirror will be able to capture the glory of the sun. The mind is like that. Mind is not going to encapsulate the truth, the sun of Atma, and bring it and put before you. If that is what the mind does, it is going to be nothing more than a psychic experience and hence not real. Therefore, the mind maintains itself clean. That is the blessing of the words. The words make the mind sattva. They make the mind surrender. So that is the job the words do. Otherwise, what happens, you know, we get caught in the web of verbal definitions and formulations. We live in formulations. 10 plus 3 plus 2. Entire life we live like that. Life means, so childhood, kindergarten, then 10, then 3, then 2, then marriage, then 2 children, then own home, then America visit, then continue like that, and then sannyasa, and then something else, all formulations. We live in formulas. So what happens is we get entangled in the web of verbal definitions and formulations. You see, truth cannot be captured by a formula. formula can at the best be empirical, and it can help in the journey. Nothing more than that. Therefore, there is in one, you see, every thought is like an iceberg. If there is a speech, if there is a word that you speak, there is a thought behind that word. Sankalpat jayate vak. So sankalpa is there and then vak comes forth. So behind the word, there is a thought. But then every thought is like a tip, like the tip of an iceberg. Behind the thought, there is an infinite realm of reality. And the thought can help us in taking to that reality by just surrendering itself. And so therefore the Upanishadic statements, they help in preparing the mind and ripening the mind so that only a ripe mind can surrender. In life, we generally do not give up anything. We don't know how to give up. A stage should come when you give up everything. In fact, you have to give up the effort to know Ishvara. Then only you will know Ishvara. As long as you seek Ishvara, there is the otherness, because in seeking, there is the otherness. In trying to know, there is the otherness. As long as the otherness is there, where is the question of knowing? Even if you know, you assume that you have known, but that is not the truth. So this is how it is a very careful balance. Sometimes the balance, one has to stay with it. It is not just one class or two classes like that. So in a given time, we are able to present something or the other. So it has to be done again and again. So anyway, coming to the point, so there is in every person the core of being. That core of the being, it is beyond the analysis. It is the analysis of the mind. It is beyond the mind. Therefore, so the legitimate function, then what is the legitimate function for words and mind? The words and mind, they work in tandem. So the legitimate function of the words and mind is to make us know what I am not. That is how, so the description, manaso vachasa magamyam, that initial statement of Shankara in the Vakya, that is substantiated by the hetu, vacho vibhanti nikhila yad anugrahena. So how words can capture the truth, because, you know, why not? Because, you see, the words themselves, they are illuminated by the grace, by the blessing of which reality? You see, yat vacha anabhyuditam, yena vaka abhyudyate, kena vachana. Yat vacha anabhyuditam, which reality, yet vacha anabhyuditam, which is not explained by the words. Why it is not explained? Because it is unexplainable by the words. That is the meaning. Vacha anabhyuditam, which cannot be captured by the words. Then, yena vaka abhyudyate. The vak is a force that is emanating from the source which is Atma. The standard example given is, if you are operating a tongs with the hand, the tongs can hold on to any object other than the hand itself. That is the a physical example. Similarly, the vak, it can capture anything outside the world. It can capture within itself. That means the meaning of the word is particular object. That is what you mean by capturing. Capturing means not like tongs capturing. So the word, suppose I said mountain. There is a huge object there. That entire object has become the meaning of this word. Mountain. MOUNTAIN. That is what is meant by capturing. Therefore, words can capture the entire, they can capture galaxies, the world, the entire universe they can capture. In fact, you can write books on the universe. But the words cannot revert back, like even the tongs cannot revert back and capture the hand that operates the tongs. So similarly, the words cannot revert back and capture their source. విచ్ ఇస్ ది ఆత్మన్. యత్ వాచా అనభ్యుదితం ఏన వాగభ్యుద్యతే, దట్ ఈస్ వాట్ హీ సేయింగ్. వాచో విభాంతి నిఖిలాః యదనుగ్రహేణ యస్య ఆత్మనః అనుగ్రహేణ, యాజ్ ది ఆత్మా బ్లెసెస్ ది, ఇట్ ఇంపార్ట్స్ ద పవర్. బ్లెస్సింగ్ మీన్స్ వాట్? ఇంపార్టింగ్ ది పవర్ టు ది స్పీచ్. ఇన్ ఫ్యాక్ట్ దెర్ ఈజ్ ఎ టూ ఫోల్డ్ ఎమనేషన్ ఆఫ్ పవర్ ఫ్రమ్ ది సోర్స్. సోర్స్ ఈజ్ ఆత్మా, విచ్ ఇస్ బ్రహ్మన్. ఎ టూ ఫోల్డ్ ఎమనేషన్ ఆఫ్ పవర్ అండ్ దట్ టూ ఫోల్డ్ శాఖయోర్ద్వయి, టూ బ్రాంచెస్ ఆఫ్ పవర్ దే ఆర్. వన్ ఈజ్ ది పవర్ ఆఫ్ యాక్షన్, మోటివ్ పవర్ ప్రాణ, అండ్ ది అదర్ ఈజ్ ది పవర్ ఆఫ్ నోయింగ్. సో విజ్ఞాన, విజ్ఞానశక్తి, క్రియాశక్తి, ఎ టూ ఫోల్డ్ ఎమనేషన్. అండ్ దిస్ వాక్ ఈజ్ ఇండీడ్ వన్ పాయింట్ ఆర్ వన్ థింగ్ వేర్ బోత్ పవర్స్ దే మెర్జ్. సో వెన్ యూ స్పీక్ ఎ వర్డ్, ఇన్ దట్ వర్డ్ దేర్ ఈజ్ ప్రాణశక్తి. అన్లెస్ యూ హ్యావ్ ప్రాణశక్తి, హౌ ఆర్ యూ గోయింగ్ టు స్పీక్? సపోజ్ ఐ డిడ్ నాట్ టేక్ ఫుడ్ ఇన్ ది మార్నింగ్ బ్రేక్ఫాస్ట్, ఐ హ్యావ్ నాట్ టేకెన్, సో ఐ విల్ నాట్ బి ఏబుల్ టు స్పీక్ యాజ్ వెల్, యు నో. దేర్ఫోర్ ప్రాణశక్తి మస్ట్ బి దేర్, దేర్ మస్ట్ బి ఎనర్జీ, దట్ లైఫ్ వైటాలిటీ, vital force, that is prana, that vital force is there in speech. And then the power of knowledge is also there, whatever little or more, whatever you know something when you speak, you know. Therefore both they come together in one organ, and that is speech. And so this power of knowing and the power of life, they both originate in the source, which is atma. And so this speech, which is at the other end of the flow of these two powers, how can it revert back and capture the glory of the reality? It cannot. That is how. So vacho vibhanti nikhilaha yad anugrahena. In fact, having said that much, we have to give their importance to the words, because Upanishads are words as they reach to us. As they emanated, they are not so many words really. In fact, Upanishadic literature or Vedic vision, it is a shruti. It is not something written. It is a shruti. That is what you hear. When you hear, what is the source? A visionary spoke the mantra, Upanishadic mantra, Rishi Darshanat. He saw the truth, or he realized the truth, and then that realization has an expression. It comes out in the form of words. So already there is a distance between the truth and the words. And then those words come to you and come to me, and so we receive it further. So the words have originated from the source. That kind of a connection they have. Therefore they have some relevance. It's not that the words are not relevant. The words take us to a stage where words become irrelevant. The mind helps us to reach a point where mind becomes no mind, amani bhava. So what happens is, this is how it operates. We can still use some negative words. That is what he is coming to next. Yam neti neti vachanaihi nigama avochan. You see, the shrutis have presented the truth not in terms of so much of positive descriptions. You may find some kind of a positive description here and there, because Vedanta, it prepares the ground, a lot of ground it prepares. Ultimately it culminates in one statement, Tattvamasi. So to say Tattvamasi, you need to prepare a lot of ground. And while preparing that ground, there are many experiments, this and that. So many experiments are also there. So it looks as if it is a kind of a social science laboratory. Like that Chandogya 6th chapter, it looks like that. So like that, there is a relevance for empirical things also. It's not that they are entirely negated. But when the reality itself has to be presented, all positive descriptions, they fall back. And now comes, everything is a negative description. In fact, I do not remember the entire passage from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. I already mentioned a few words, ahrasvam adirgham. All opposites are taken up and negated. So it is like this. You provide the details of the empirical world. And then I will tell you what Brahman is not. You provide the details of the person that you are, or you take yourself to be. You provide the details of the personality. I will tell you what Atma is not. It is like that. That is how the words operate. So, you tell me, for example, you tell me the details of the person. The person is a pita, atma apita, mata amata, abhrata, abandhuhu, aputraha. Like that. You provide the details, I will tell you what atma is not. You provide the details of the body, generally that is what you do, and I will tell you what atma is not. So, born on a particular day, ajaha, atma is ajaha, it was not born at all, waiting to die, amaraha, it is not going to die, it became already old or about to become old, ajaraha, it is not going to become old. Then, atma, the person, the jiva goes to heaven and comes back, atma doesn't go anywhere, doesn't come back. And achala it is, achalaha nachalati. So like this, you provide the details of the person, I will tell you not what is Atma. I will tell you what Atma is not. You see the sentence, I have twisted this way to that way. So this is how the words operate. In fact, I tell you, at the level of the mind also, the words, they operate in a very interesting way. Because, you know, the mind is operating, functioning means there is only one way that the mind can function. That is, it must separate and it must oppose in order to know. That is how the mind functions. The mind has to know the flower, means it must function, it must operate in a way that it must separate and it must oppose. It must separate it and then oppose. Then only it can know. Otherwise it cannot know. Therefore, where there is separation, where there is opposition, how can you know? So how can you objectify the truth? Therefore, reality cannot be described in terms of a mental thought. The mind has its own limitation. So, but the mind can help us, like the words can help us. How? It has done its job when it brings us to the very frontiers of knowledge. And then you are left there. In the frontiers of knowledge it takes you and leaves you there. And there you are face to face with the immensity of the unknown and unknowable. And you lose yourself in the immensity of the unknown and unknowable. You are one with Brahman. That is realization. That is how it happens. So we will be saying both ways. So mind helps us because you see, to reach the ripening of silence, you need words. To reach the unknown, the frontiers of the immensity of the unknown, you need a mental process of training. In fact, I tell you, you have to train the mind so that it won't come in the way. Because the mind is rajasic and sattvic. You have to clean the mirror, not that the mirror will go and bring the sun. You have to clean the mirror so that the dirt won't come in the way and the sun will reflect. Similarly, the mind is purified. The tamas and rajas of the mind are negated and it remains in sattva. I tell you, the sattvic mind, It is a kind of a frontier between the unknown and the known. The sattvic mind, it flips. You have the world, it flips. It is Brahman. Like that. That is the sattvic mind. So up to that, it helps us. And then the Upanishadic statements, they have a very interesting role to play. You see, the words that are used, they are empty of meaning. They don't have any meaning. Suppose I say, time, you have a meaning in it. There is a meaning in it. You may not be able to explain the meaning, but you can visualize the meaning, time. So you say one day, a day, you know, it is a measure of time, you know it. Then similarly, length, 10 feet, you know it. So the word has a meaning in it. And suppose I say timeless. When I said timeless, the word timeless has no specific or special meaning of its own. I have taken the word time and emptied it of its meaning. And then threw that word upon you, timeless. Kala tita rakala, akal, sat shri akal. Now you handle it. Akal. Really? Sat shri akal. Sat is the reality. Shri is because of our devotion. It is akal, it is. Nirak, alak niranjan. Alak niranjan. Alak. You cannot see it. You cannot visualize it with the mind. Niranjan. It has no opposites in it. It has not the impurity of the distinctions and separations in it. Alak niranjan. So, when I say timeless, you think that you have now got a word with meaning. Is it a word with meaning, timeless? Is it not a word that is emptied of its meaning altogether? So then what happens is, mind, it reacts in a way to words. The words, they carry distinctions in them. And then when I throw a word at you, your mind, it relates to the distinction, like a fish to water. Because mind, in the process of, in its operations, it, as I already said, it separates and opposes. That is its pastime. And therefore, when I throw a word at you, the word carrying all the divisions and distinctions, then you relate to it happily. You relate to that word. The mind beautifully relates to that word. On the other hand, when I throw a word at you, which is emptied of its meaning, in fact, I don't hesitate to call it a meaningless word, like timeless. It is a meaningless word. You tell me what is its meaning? Timeless. It's a meaningless word. When I throw it at you, the mind, you know, it doesn't know how to react to it. Because the word doesn't carry any distinction. It doesn't carry any separation. It doesn't carry any meaning to which the mind is accustomed. And then the mind, it gets in a way stunned. And if it is a prepared mind, if it is not a prepared mind, like if it is a rajasic mind, you know what will it say? It will say, in Vedanta these people talk all these things only, let us go and have a cup of coffee. That is what the rajasic mind will say. And if it is a tamasic mind, it will go to sleep. Or it just remains in some reverie, whatever. Whereas a sattvic mind, it gets stunned. And immediately, it is already reached the frontiers of the immensity of the unknown. That is how the words can help you to reach the frontiers of the unknown. And you have to discover for yourself a few things. Number one, the persona that I take myself to be is a pale shadow of that reality. As that reality, which is the immense, which is ananta, satyam jnanam anantam, brahma it is, as it is reflecting in this body mind, the person is the pale shadow it is. And we are living a shadow's life. When you say, I have a personal career, you are talking of the career of a shadow. I'm not saying you don't pursue your career and all that. God bless you, you go on pursuing your career and make us feel comfortable. So that part of it is, I'm not against it. I am just blabbering the words of a philosopher, nothing more than that. So therefore some of the worldly things also do come occasionally. The person is a very pale shadow. And it is not that I say it and you hear. It doesn't mean anything. So what happens is, we absorb everything into the old.
All new is absorbed into the old. And so new is now neutralized by the old, and old remains old. And new, it got neutralized, it is just absorbed. That doesn't work, you know. So that is not the point. The point is, the mind gets stunned. And then, so once the mind is stunned into, and then it resolves in its source, and source is there only. The reality is near. You do not have to seek it. In fact, a man who seeks the truth will never find it, because there is always the otherness in seeking. That's why you drop all mental effort and just be. Truth is in what is. What is, that is the truth, and that is the beauty of the truth. The moment you conceive the truth, the moment you seek it, you begin to struggle. And a struggling person cannot understand the truth. You should stop all struggle, then only you will understand the truth. All struggle to know. Struggle to know means what? I am here, and the truth is outside, truth is other, and I have to know it. So as long as that is the essence of a struggle. And first you struggle, as you struggle and struggle and struggle, and reach a point where all struggle ends. And you are into the reality at that time. Anyway, therefore, we use such words like timeless, spaceless, causeless. Suppose you say causeless, because the mind, it is accustomed to function in the principles of causality. In fact, I tell you, we live in a cell, a prison cell, created by us, for us, by the mind, built by the mind. The prison cell consisting of three walls, just you imagine like that. The walls of space, time, and the principle of causality. These are the three walls. Desha, Kala, and Karya Karana Bhava. As long as, because when you are working in Karya Karana Bhava, the cause-effect relationship, in that relationship when you are working in the flow of time. Because Karana is earlier, Karya is later. In the flow of time, you are working in the continuity of time. As long as you work in the continuity of time, in the confines of space, you do not know the truth. You do not come to the truth. Truth remains at a distance. Though it is near, it is at a distance. Yad dure tadvantike. Therefore, you rise above the cause-effect relationship. You rise above the time. Be the timeless reality. That is you. That is your true nature. And you come to communion with it. You be that. And then slowly it starts flowing into the shadow life. Now it is entirely closed up. And once you come to that communion, it starts flowing. As it flows, then you will realize quite a few things. Like, for example, when you see the movie on the screen, even while seeing it, you know that it is dikhavat, appearance only. There is no reality to it. It is appearing, but it is not real. What a beautiful thing it is. And you assume, suppose it is appearing and it is real, then what will be? Suppose you see some blood on the screen and you dial 911, that kind of a thing it is. And our life is like that. We will be dialing 911 all the time for an imaginary issue, problem. So, that is the beauty of it. As you come to communion with that reality, as you appreciate the meaning of the words, neti neti. In fact, in Brihadaranyaka, we have a law, neti neti tyadeshaha. Adeshaha is upadeshaha, all upadesha is in negative terms only. All upadesha. You know what does it mean? It only means this, all negative understanding is the highest understanding. That is how it is. So be satisfied, be saturated with all your positive understanding, and be done with it, and then come to the negative understanding. Then the words, the negative words, the words emptied of meaning, then they will do the trick. So, neti neti iti adeshaha, yam neti neti vachanaihi, nigama avochan, Shruti. We have highest regard for the Shruti, because the Shruti is the spontaneous outpouring of a realized soul. It is not the product of an well-informed ego. That is not what it is. A well-informed persona, not that. It is the spontaneous outpouring. When Shruti comes out, there is no person behind it. There is no center in it. There is only speech. There is no center. There is a vision without a center. Center is the ego, I mean. So that kind of a thing it is. And so we have the highest regard for Shruti. It is equivalent to Ishvara. It is Ishvara. And yet, Shankara says that Shruti. Shankara is one of the greatest of the Vaidikas. He says Shruti, it only uses such words. Neti neti. Neti neti tyadeshaha. Their website is neti neti. It doesn't mean it is said twice. It means it is said again and again and again. That is the meaning of saying it twice. Indriyasya indriyasya arthe. When indriyasya is repeated twice, it doesn't mean two indriyas. It means all indriyas. When it is said neti neti tyadeshaha, it doesn't mean there are two sentences which follow this method. It means all Upadesha is in neti neti. Then what about other vakyas? They are preparing the ground. So ultimately, neti neti vachanaihi nigama avochan. So, tam deva devam ajamachyuta mahuragriyam. That atma, which is presented before us, not in terms of positive words, but in terms of negative words only. In fact, I tell you, to know the self, it is just enough. You know what you are not. That is enough. What you are, you need not know. You are not going to know. You can only be what you are. How can you know what you are? You can only mistake what you are not for yourself. And so the entire effort is to correct the mistake. You see, if you are already the divinity, then what is the effort, what is the meaning of, what is the purpose of the effort? To make you divine? No. Just to negate all the misconceptions that one has about oneself. That is how it works. So there are positive sentences, etc., as I told you, in the preparatory level. But I am talking of a level where no positive statement has any relevance. Yam neti neti vachanai. So nigama avochan tam deva devam. You see, deva deva means, it doesn't mean devatas are in the clouds and there is a boss of those devatas residing much above even the clouds. That is not the meaning, you know. Deva is the indriya, speech, and eyesight. These are devaha. And deva deva, the speech is blessed by what? That atma. And the mind is blessed by what? Yan manasana manute. Yena manaha manute. Like that in Kena. So, the mind is blessed. So that now it has the faculty of knowing a few things here and there. It can operate in its sphere. Everything has its sphere. You see, they capture only that thing which vibrates in a given frequency. If a thing vibrates with a higher frequency, eyes cannot capture. Why? If the fan rotates speedily, you don't see the blades. It is as simple as that. That is what eyes are. And the mind, the blessed thing, it is nothing more than what you see and what you hear. That is what mind is. What else is the mind? So even if forms are there, those forms, if they vibrate at a higher frequency, they are beyond the scope of the mind. Leave alone Brahma. Really. So, these devas, these indriyas, they are blessed by that atma. That is the deva deva. Vishnu. What is the location of Vishnu? Vaikuntha. You know what is Vaikuntha? Vaikuntha is a hridayasthanam. Hridayam is this is the Vaikuntha. And here is Vishnu, deva devam. And you see, there is no birth for this Vishnu. That atma, it has no birth. This birth is for the shadow person. And it is not yearly once. You should do birthday party every day morning. Because the shadow person is born, every morning it is born and every night it dies. And so every night it is the death, nitya pralayam and nitya srishti. So that is what the shadow, so every day morning we have to do birthday party. Because the shadow person is born now. It died yesterday night. Ajam, it has no birth. Achyutam, you see, suppose the mind operates between distinctions. That is the chyuti. Chyuti means slipping down. So the mind operates between distinctions, between opposites. And the reality is beyond the opposites. It is sama. Now, as the mind is upheld by the reality, then in upholding the reality, did the Atman slip down to the level of the mind or not? Suppose you go to court to give a witness on behalf of one of the two parties, the prosecution and the defense. So on behalf of prosecution or defense let us say, you go and give witness. Now while giving witness on behalf of the defense, did you not identify with one of the opposites? Yes, you did. And while identifying with one of the opposites, did you not have the animosity towards the other? You are already in the grip of likes and dislikes. So similarly, when Atma upholds the opposites, that is the mind is nothing but a group of opposites, a conglomerate of opposites. When Atma upholds the mind, does it fall down to the level of opposites? No. Therefore, in waking state, when the mind is in full swing, operating in the opposites and distinctions, yet Atma remains intact while upholding the... That is the beauty. It is not that it remains intact without upholding. No. While upholding, while being immanent, it remains transcendent. That is what is called Achyuta. It blesses without being affected. Achyutam. Agriyam. You see, what is the first? Is the body first? No, there is a mind. You see, as long as one thinks that there is a mind in the body and there is an Atma in the mind, he never comes to know the truth. You have to put it topsy-turvy. There is Atma. All easiness is Atma. And in that easiness, the mind is a bubble-like reflecting surface. And in that mind, body arises as an idea. What you call body is nothing more than an idea in the mind. And what you call mind is none other than a movement on the surface of Atma, on the surface of awareness. Surface means, I mean metaphorically, not physically. Like a wave on the ocean. So which is first? Is the body first? Or is the mind first? Or is the Atma first? Atma, the awareness, is the first. You can experience it in your daily life. You wake up. Which is first? The awareness that Chetana, you are just about to become aware of various differences or distinctions. That Chetana, that potential awareness, that is first. Then comes mind. And then comes body. What happens, you know, and then comes things that are connected to the body, that are related to the body. And eventually, we get so badly engrossed in the affairs of the body and of the mind that it never occurs to us that there is a source, a griyam. So forget about the affairs of the body-mind. Those affairs will be there forever. You have resolved one bodily issue, one more is waiting for you. That's why we need to take insurance. And you have resolved one mental issue, one more is just waiting for you. Because one issue gives birth to another issue. It is a cycle. So you resolved one issue, one more thing will come. There is one way of resolving it. Just ignore it. You are not your mind. Don't take your mind seriously. Then slowly you inch towards that agriyam. It is there all the time. It is like you are enamored with gold, with a necklace, and don't know what is gold. That is the kind of situation we are talking about. The person is so much overwhelmed by the beauty of the necklace that he doesn't know, the person doesn't know what is gold. That is the kind of situation that we are talking about. Anyway, a little viveka doesn't harm. Have some viveka. That kind of viveka is necessary. To know that I am not the body is essential to before you know that I am all. Therefore, agriyam ahuhu, that agriyam, the beginning of everything that you call life, that source, that beginning, on that I contemplate and I relish that contemplation. That is the verse. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnamidam Purnamidachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om Tat Sat Shri Krishna Paramahamsa.